with the proposed planning board will do that. And so that was an interesting way to really compare what the changes were as a result of the bike lane. And so we saw the growth that happened in cycling in the Bloor section was quite different from the other section that we looked at. So, you know, we know that there's this growth happening across the city, but when we put in this infrastructure, there's like an immediate like bump.
Question I have is relative to that bump and if we're looking at how your communities are dealing with the cascade for bike storage at hubs like transit hubs and things like that, that you see in Europe where multi-story bike parking garage is going up next to those e-hubs. So are those things appearing or is the pressure for that on it? GO stations or on Toronto Transit where space is so tight?
Yeah, for sure. It's in the city's bike plan. They have a parking strategy as part of the bike plan. So it's something that they're looking at to increase both for long-term bike storage, like at transit, as well as short-term storage. We're actually working with the city on a project to figure out how to increase bike parking in Toronto community housing buildings. In particular, one of the things that we found is that apartment buildings have even fewer options for bike parking than other types of residences. So, like, there's lots to do for sure, but the city is definitely has part of that as their strategy, just increasing the bike parking.
So, my follow up to that is then how does that reflect the design of the street when you see a large uptick in bicycle use, and where do those bikes get stored so that they don't become barriers between the street, the parking, the bike lanes, and the retail and shops and things like that, and they will just fill the sidewalks?
Yeah, so that's a really good question. So you'll see a lot of bike corrals being installed where people take one or two parking spaces on the road and they create biking parking for that. But we talked about transit stations too. In Ontario or in the GTHA, all new and refurbished GO stations will have new bike routes. It's in their new station design requirements. We're an engineering firm, we're obligated to follow those. We're doing a few of them. It's quite surprising that they have an outdoor shelter, but now all new stations will have indoor parking rooms with multi-level parking. At Union Station, the City of Toronto, they have a fabulous, you know, a lot of people don't know it's there, bike parking right inside the old train station. Really well used. You have this vending machine there. You can buy a park for your bike. I don't know if it works. Last time I was there, it was a professional. City Hall has one too. So we're seeing that uptake really fast. I think big cities are just now here realizing that they don't have enough equipment. And with the advent of things like e-scooter, with e-bikes, bike share that have docking stations is manageable. But dockless biking stations is a whole different animal. People are taking it. Where they can park their bike. They're responsible for that bike while they're on the ticket and paying for it. So we have a lot to deal with that. I mean, Toronto has bike racks everywhere on the arterial roads between the curbs and the tip. But you know, you can just drive down Bloor or some of the other streets and there's like, you know, two or three deep sometimes. So if we're getting to that point where like infrastructure, we're not far enough ahead on infrastructure for bike parking. So it's a good lesson for Regina and other cities too before you get there. Started thinking about that. In terms of our condo development, residential development too, we're seeing a lot of cities requiring very secure bike parking rooms, bike parking, bike back is a tradition, especially in cities like Toronto and other cities. So developers are putting those in, and actually many of them are providing additional bike parking kind of facilities, including lanes right down the parking ramps. And as a result, downtown, they're being allowed to not deal with as much automobile. So for them, it's a really good deal. In fact, there's a story, I'm not sure what city it is, how they might remember, her developer actually, I believe he's not providing any automobile parking. Instead of providing bikes, everyone moves in. You get a bike, it's part of the deal, but you don't get a bike car parking spot. And people make decisions where they live, and that developer concluded that there is enough demand in the market for that kind of product, and it seems to be great. So,
So the whole bike parking issue is something that I think we just are sort of behind the gun a little bit, so to speak.
Our policies are playing catch up.
Yeah.
We don't have supportive policies to say, and design guidelines to say, this is what we are expecting to accommodate. That's what comment earlier about GIS and understanding data, being proactive of understanding where your cyclists are going and mapping those areas, and then working with the developers that could be in the area, the businesses, the representatives from community centers or libraries, that sort of thing, to together identify what those are. Sometimes we talk to them also trying to anticipate demand in certain locations. There are absolutely some of the areas to try and
I think on the bike parking thing, Nancy, ADEB has a really good bike parking guide and based on best practices across North America, kind of maybe others that you can point to. That would be a great start for you guys to look at first, because it provides different guidance on the kind of bike parking, the type of bike parking, based on different land uses and density, both publicly accessible and on private property. So it's a very useful guide. I think a lot of municipalities are looking at that, update their zoning bylaws to try to start putting that into policy. But like Kurt said, we're attacking that from now.
Yeah, it's a great question, and for you in the back, you might not have heard, but just about what about winter and in these road designs where you're reducing from, you know, the number of vehicle lanes. One of the things in Toronto that they've been doing is to also be plowing the bike lanes so that there's been a real increase in winter cycling in Toronto. And that's something that we've seen, like, as far as best practice, you know, from in the bicycle-friendly kind of countries in Germany and Netherlands, that's exactly what they do as well. It's like they're very cold climates, but they really provide that all-year-round cycling infrastructure for cyclists. But it is interesting that there's this, and we found this both in terms of the need for on-street parking, but also the need for lanes for vehicles, that it is possible to reduce those in many cases, that it feels like there's not enough room, but when you actually do it, and in most cases these are done on a pilot project with SAS, when you actually do it, you find that on the other side of it, it's like, what happened to the traffic? We don't know if they just changed their time of day, or if they changed modes, what it is, but the kind of impacts that there's been a worry that we would see have just not happened. I don't know if you guys have any examples.
I think that's true. I think, you know, it's important. In Canada, we have something called TAC, the Transportation Association of Canada. In 2017, they updated the geometric design guideline for roadway design for all of Canada. And a significant change is the recommendations about reducing winter travel lanes and the context and sort of situation where you do that. It's a dramatic change from the old guidelines that we had in TAC, and it took into consideration winter maintenance and snow removal versus snow clearing, snow storage. But you know, it varies depending on where you are in Canada. I think some municipalities who are rolling out bike networks actually store snow in their bike lanes, and they only maintain a winter cycling network, and the cycling community understands that, or even maps. Ottawa is one of those cities that does it. Montreal too, but Montreal is trying to every year maintain more and more of their cycling network because they're seeing a significant rise in winter cycling. Ottawa has it too, but not at the same kind of rate as Montreal. St. Tyler, Calgary, and Edmonton, that's the approach there.
Yeah, they've created, right now they're using their civilized vehicle policy, but they plow certain corridors of priority one, and so we get out there and remove the snow and actually do a brining treatment to address icing. And I think Minneapolis is usually one that we use a lot in Canada. They're very similar to the rest of our prairie provinces in terms of right now, I think, is retaining around a third of their summer riders, and a lot of them switch to transit, some in the transit. So there's a bit of a flex between the ridership and the recycling and transit, and it's even now.
I think before we wrap up, we're going to have about a half minute. I just want to emphasize that the blocking of the lane is not done. So, where possible, there's a rationale, a rigor,